Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. You probably know by now that we study the Sabbath School lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And this particular series is a series on the book of Matthew. We're studying this series in the book in the months of April, May, and June of 2016. And this is lesson number 8 in that series entitled Peter and the Rock. I thought Peter was supposed to be a rock. Some people think so. This is a lesson from May 21 of 2016. Before we begin, we hope you have your Bible handy because we're going to be looking at some passages, and you're not going to have to jump around a lot. Most of the passages are plus or minus a couple pages in the book of Matthew, so it should be easy. Let's begin with a word of prayer. Our wonderful Father, it is a great blessing to welcome your presence, even though we know you're here always, as we participate in this discussion together. May we represent you the best we can. Guide us through the influence of your Holy Spirit to say what you want us to say is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. So where are we in terms of history with this lesson? If you had only the books of Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and not the Gospel of John, you would think that the entire history of the ministry of Jesus Christ lasted only 1 year. That there was 1 year in Galilee, there was a trip to Jerusalem, and there was that final week, and Jesus is crucified, and it's all over. But John tells us a different story, and we know, after putting the whole story together, that Jesus had now completed a year and a half of working in Judea. And when John the Baptist was arrested and put in prison in Machaerus, Jesus moved from Judea to Galilee. About 1 year later, John was beheaded. And Jesus had fed the 5,000 Jews up near the top end of the Sea of Galilee, near Bethsaida. And they, of course, the people were all excited. They were sure that their Messiah had come, the Messiah they were looking for. And they followed him to Capernaum, and they wanted to be fed again. And Jesus said, no, that's not what I came for. And there was a very frank discussion. If you want to read that, it's found in John chapter 6. And that was followed by a very frank discussion with the Pharisees and Sadducees. And then Jesus did something very unusual. He took his disciples and he said, we're leaving here. And they departed for the territory of Tyre and Sidon. Now, this is the first time, not the first time they had been outside of primarily Jewish territory. They had been over to Gadara on the other side of the Jordan and so forth over there, on the other side of the Sea of Galilee, once or twice. But this is the first time Jesus has taken his disciples out. And we know for a fact that it was about 6 months that he was out there. He came back into Galilean territory just very briefly a couple of times. But basically, he's out there traveling around in those territories, Gentile territories. He went from Tyre and Sidon over, I guess I should do it this way, over close to the coast. Then he went down and over to up near the foot of the mountain into Caesarea Philippi, where Herod Philip was the king. And we'll talk more about that a little bit later. And then finally he comes down, and somewhere along the east coast of the Sea of Galilee, we presume, there was the experience of the Transfiguration. This 6 month period in which Jesus is working with his disciples primarily to prepare them for the time when he will be gone is sometimes referred to as his retirement. And it's going to be followed by 6 months in which Jesus travels around and attracts great crowds of people, and finally he makes a slow progress with hundreds and maybe thousands of people following him on his way to Jerusalem, where of course he will be. Contrary to what they all think, they think he's on his way to Jerusalem to be crowned king, he ends up being arrested and crucified, as we know. So that's a little bit of the historical background, what we're talking about. So what was happening up there in the area of Tyre and Sidon? This isn't a mystery. What did Jesus do up there?
Well, you mentioned it briefly a little bit ago. He was up there in Gentile territory, and it was probably the first major time that he'd taken them up there to work, his disciples, to work with the Gentiles.
Yes. And while he was there, he met a Canaanite-ish woman, and what did he do?
He healed her daughter.
Yeah, he healed her daughter, exactly. And Ellen White seems to suggest that he went there purposely to heal her daughter. We don't know exactly how far he went, whether he actually went to the cities of Tyre and Sidon. Probably not, probably just up into that territory. But then...
Do we have any follow-up on that to know why he would go all that distance just for one person?
Other than what Ellen White says, you mean?
What did she say about it?
Well, she just says that that's what he went up there for. And basically, what we're seeing in this whole section of Matthew is Jesus is trying to get his disciples to see, and he's not very successful at it, unfortunately, to get his disciples to see that the gospel is for Gentiles and not just for Jews.
Was that the first time that he was making that point?
No. What happened with the two demoniacs at Gadara? And what did he tell those demoniacs to do?
Go and tell your story.
Go and tell your story. We'll talk about what happened as a result of that a little bit later. Well, Matthew 16:21 tells us, from that time on, Jesus began to say plainly to his disciples. Now, when it says to begin to say plainly to his disciples, what does that imply?
It implies that he'd said it in not such plain ways previously.
Simple
he'd
as
hinted
he
at it.
Well, he said it as simple as possible. In other words, what did he intend for them to do?
He wanted to change their focus a little bit.
He wanted them to understand what he was saying, no? I mean, okay,
also, and to prepare them for the event when it came. And because they weren't prepared, it hit them really, really hard.
And what did he say? Here it is, right in Matthew 16. We're going to find out it's going to be repeated several more times, right up to the time he's on his way up to Jerusalem from Jericho. He says, I must go. There's no question about this. I must go to Jerusalem and suffer much from the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law. I will be put to death, but 3 days later I will be raised to life.
Would the word direct be a better term here than plain? When we read plain, it's just explained a little more clearly than he did in the past, but mm-hmm. if you use the word direct, he's getting more specific. He's trying to not just teach, he's trying to wake them up. He's trying to just really make sure they know what's...
Okay, and I'm 100% with you. But think about this. Here we have the greatest teacher who's ever walked planet Earth. And he has a group of disciples who've been following him officially as disciples for at least a year, or very close to it. Some of them have been following him off and on for 3.5 years, or no, 2.5 years at this point in time. 2.5 years they've been following him. Some of them, James and John, might even have been his cousins. And he says, sit down, I want to tell you something. Make it as plain and straightforward, direct, whatever term you want to use. I want to tell you what's going to happen to me. And did they get it?
No. It just shows how we have a paradigm, and when somebody tells us something, we try to fit it into that rather than hearing what's being said.
Is there any paradigm or paradigms we have in our church today that...
Now, Jay, you know better than to ask a question like that.
Well, I
Well, I'll give you
other Christian groups, and obviously there, but I'm.
There are some Adventists who think that somehow by magic, the Seventh-day Adventist Church is on a bus that's headed for the kingdom, and so long as you don't get off of the bus, you're going to make it to the kingdom. Do I need to say any more?
It's compliments of C.S. Lewis.
Well. Say C.S. Lewis you want. That's okay, well...
Any others?
Uh-oh.
What do you want me to do? Scare everybody out of listening to our program? Okay, repeatedly he told them that he must go to Jerusalem, be arrested by the Jewish leaders, and be handed over to the Romans, and that he would die. Now, how difficult is that to understand? Is this mystical language? Is this... Well, really complicated terminology.
He's spoken in parables before. Well, he's used a lot of parables, so now just here's another parable.
Okay.
And we got to try and figure this one out too.
Okay, so what did the disciples do when he said when he spoke a mysterious parable that they didn't understand?
They asked, what does it mean?
What does it mean? Though they should have asked. If that was the case, they should have asked, what does it mean? Well, unfortunately, and this is not part of the regular lesson, but I have to take you to Luke 18, 31 to 34. Luke 18, 31 to 34, and I read, Jesus, now this is clear at the very end. They're walking from Jericho up to Jerusalem. 1 week from now, Jesus is, one week from this point, Jesus is going to be dead. Okay? Jesus took the 12 disciples aside and said to them, by the way, what's going on here? There are hundreds and maybe thousands of people crowding around him up the mountain here in this narrow pass from Jericho to Jerusalem. And what is their absolutely certain plan in their minds?
Jesus.
He's going to go to Jerusalem and he's going to be crowned king. They are certain of it, and the disciples are certain of it. Jesus takes the 12 disciples aside and says to them, listen, we are going to Jerusalem where everything the prophets wrote about the Son of Man will come true. And they're thinking of all those glorious phrases that in the Old Testament, wow, wonderful, he's going to be king. Oh, this is wonderful. He will be handed over to the Gentiles, huh? Where did that come in? Who will mock him, insult him, and spit on him. They will whip him and kill him, but 3 days later he will rise to life. And what did the disciples say? But the disciples did not understand any of these things. The meaning of the words was hidden from them, and they did not know what Jesus was talking about. And I can assure you, this is at least the fourth time that Jesus is recorded as saying to them, this is what's going to happen to him.
But they remembered enough of it to be able to record it years later, decades later.
You got Mark 9 says something just similar to that.
Oh, yeah, there's three or four times. It's repeated and repeated and repeated, yeah.
And so there's no place in the Gospels where Jesus explained what the efficacy of his death would be.
They weren't ready for that.
I understand that, but we say that Jesus died to pay the penalty for your sins. He never explained it.
No.
It's not there, and he surely had the opportunity.
Yeah. Well, what we have is John 16, where he says, there's a lot more things I would like to tell you, but you can't handle them now.
Right.
That's what we get.
And that's where he says, the Father loves you himself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I don't need to pray to the Father for you because the Father loves you himself. And they didn't even know what, to this day, most people don't know what to do with that text.
Mm-hmm. Well, it seems doubtful because was God intentionally blinding their minds? Why was it they couldn't understand?
Maybe someone else was blinding their minds.
Well, it seems doubtful that it could be God, because why would Jesus, if God was intentionally blinding their minds, why do we have Jesus recorded as repeatedly saying plainly, telling them straight, telling them, you know, Jesus is trying to get them to get the picture.
And these were men of native abilities,
yes.
Ellen White says.
But what about, there's another side, I think, that just occurred to me. As far as we know, it's not mentioned, and as far as we have to take it, that they didn't know that Christ had done nothing to incur the wrath of the authorities. And I'm not talking about the clergy, I'm talking about Herod and the Romans.
Yeah.
Which, in one sense, would feed into this, I think.
Mm-hmm.
If nothing is done wrong, he's been doing good. Sure, he's had a few spats with the priests, but so far.
Well, it's very clear from the Gospels and from the rest of the New Testament that Jesus had to die. Not something he was looking forward to, but he had to die. Look at John 12, verses 27 and 28. Now this is, he's in his last day in the temple court. He's been teaching there all day. The Pharisees have come, the Sadducees have come, they have tried to trap him. He always comes out smiling, and they end up looking like fools. And finally he says, now my heart, and there's these Greeks come from the west, and they say, Theleman blepain Jesus, we want to see Jesus. They approach one of his disciples. And when the disciples come to Jesus, he says, now my heart is troubled. And what shall I say? Shall I say, Father, do not let this hour come upon me? But that is why I came, so that I might go through this hour of suffering. Father, bring glory to your name. Then a voice spoke from heaven, I have brought glory to it, and I will do so again. The crowd standing there heard the voice, and some of them said it was thunder, while others said, an angel spoke to him. Try to imagine what kind of a furor that raised. But here we let's just think about the implications here. Jesus knows day by day he's getting closer to the time when he's going to go through this incredible trial. How would you feel about it if you knew in advance you're going to die an awful death, and you're working toward it step by step, you're getting closer and closer, and the people you want to clarify, you want to explain it to, aren't getting it? What do you do? He knows that this is part of the plan. He has to happen.
You tell it again.
It would intensify the feeling that he finally had he was on his own.
How far back did this part of the plan, how far does it go? When was this part of the plan first devised?
Foundation of the earth.
Yes.
Before time began is what it says in Titus 1:2, which is based on the hope for eternal life. God, who does not lie, promised us this life before the beginning of time. And there's something similar in 2 Timothy 1:9. I'm sorry, I can cheat. I can get there a lot faster than you can. He saved us and called us to be his own people, not because of what we have done, but because of his own purpose and grace. He gave us this grace by means of Christ before the beginning of time. So what does that mean? When is before the beginning of time?
Well, certainly before the creation of the earth.
Okay.
Certainly before the creation of man.
So why?
Time is relative to the viewpoint of the observer.
Yeah.
So he's talking to us. So it would be time would begin with the creation of the universe.
Well, at least this world.
Yeah.
So why was it absolutely necessary that Jesus go to Jerusalem and die? Obviously, his divine plan could have his divine power could have prevented his death even at Jerusalem. I mean, he'd come and gone from Jerusalem on a number of occasions, and he always managed to escape the attacks and the authority and the threats of the Pharisees and Sadducees.
He has to pay for our sins. Heresy.
Okay. Hold on just a minute here.
Well, he stayed and prayed to God that he'd finished the work that he came there for.
Yeah.
Romans 3:25-26, Jesus' death was to show that God is righteous.
Yeah.
To bring harmony among his creation. And that includes the beings in the heavenly places as well as the beings on this earth.
Okay. Jim is getting ahead of us here, but that's fine. Don't mind. So why is it true that Jesus has to die? Why must he face these? I mean, even if you say he has to die, look at the way he died. It was awful. And I ask you this question. Would God have done it that way if there was any other way possible?
Well, that's what Jesus asked. If there be any way to get out of this, nevertheless, not my will but thine be done. So apparently there wasn't.
So why did he have to die? Now, obviously, we could launch into a discussion that would last forever. But just briefly, the questions that had been raised when Lucifer, later Satan, rebelled in heaven about God's character and the way God runs his government had to be answered. So what do we, and even here on this earth, God said, Genesis 2:17, what did he say? Except the tree that gives knowledge of what is good and what is bad, you must not eat the fruit of that tree. If you do, you will die the same day. Now those are God's words. And what did Satan say?
That's a lie.
Genesis 3:4. Come on, guys.
You won't die.
No. Yeah. He said, you won't die. So who are we going to believe? Here we are. The snake replied, that's not true. You will not die. So we have two figures claiming to be authoritative saying opposite things. Now what do we do?
About life.
about life, about the very essence of life. That's correct. These are existential questions, as they call them.
Satan said a half-truth that for her tipped the balance.
Okay.
We have to check out the options and see the evidence.
Can Satan prove his claim that we will not die if we sin?
Well, you can if you look at people.
Well, but we all die, don't we?
Because Adam didn't, well, he didn't die that day, didn't die right away.
So he didn't die right away, and Satan tries to make a claim. And then when Adam does die and Eve does die and more people start dying, what did Satan claim?
They're going to go to heaven.
God's killing.
God is upset because they're sinning. They're doing it my way. So God is killing them. They wouldn't die by themselves. God is actually killing them. So can God prove his claim that sin does lead to death? Now, let's think about this for a moment. We don't want to spend a long time on this. We've got a lot more lesson to cover. The person who has a heart attack or the person who dies in an accident on the freeway, are they dying as a result of sin? Well, generically, yes. If nobody had ever sinned, they wouldn't be dead. So in that sense, I suppose in the global picture, it's true. But not specifically. It's not because some specific sin happened and that's what killed that person right at that point in time.
It's almost as if they're dying as a consequence of living.
Mm-hmm. Well, this is the question now. Has anyone in the history of our world actually died as a direct result of sin?
What do you mean by that?
Only Jesus.
Well, just what I said. Has anyone died of sin? Right there.
Can you define what
of
sin is?
Isaiah 59 verse 2, I'm not going to take time to go there right now, but Isaiah 59 verse 2 says, sin separates us from God. And who's the source of life?
God.
It's God.
And what to live separated from the source of life?
You can't. You can't.
And if you think of death in terms of the second death, then nobody has died except Jesus.
Okay. So we read Matthew 27:46, which says that about 3 o'clock, he's on the cross, at about 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out with a loud shout, Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani, which means, my God, why did you abandon me? Which means what? Is sin doing what between the Father and the Son?
Separating.
Separating. That is the inevitable and final result of sin. So that's sort of part of the reason why Jesus had to die, one of the major reasons.
So the disciples, who hadn't quite gotten it all yet,
yeah,
but they fell asleep while he was praying.
But he didn't sin.
Well, and that's one of the things, but 2 Corinthians 5:19 to 21 makes it very clear God treated him as if he were a sinner, so that we can get the picture.
And the Father didn't lay a finger on him.
No, he didn't. He just let him go. And that's what that's all about.
A bit of a conundrum, a logical conundrum, because if you sin, you're separating yourself from the life source, and therefore you die. And Jesus didn't sin, so how could he die because he didn't separate himself from?
Okay, well, here's the problem, and again, I say we could go on this forever. God allows, if one of us, God says, I'm going to make you an example, I'm going to separate you from me and see what happens, you're dead forever. That's it. But Jesus was God. So he was able to die as a human being, but on Sunday when his Father called him, he was able to energize his divine power and come back to life. Only Jesus could do that. Nobody else could do that. You can't do that. I can't do that. None of us will ever be able to do that. So God says, here's someone who can die and come back to life to prove several things. We don't have time to go through all the things he was proving by doing that. But here is a chance for you to see that someone who is, it's not because of something that happened to him, not because of the beatings, not because of the crown of thorns, not because of the crucifixion. He dies of sin. Yes, Jim.
Didn't Jesus say, I lay down my life and I take it up again.
I have the power to lay it down. I have the power to take it up again.
In a way, he was saying, you're not even going to get a chance to kill me.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to happen on my terms.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, and I don't want to diminish. I think this helps to emphasize the point you're making here. And I don't want to diminish what Jesus went through during that terrible time. But, you know, as I read the stories of Paul, Paul was flogged many times,
mm-hmm.
and he was stoned several times, and he was left for dead several times, and that's just the beginning of all that he went through.
Yes.
So when you compare those types of things compared to what Jesus went through, Paul went through...
Okay, if you take that route, you're into big trouble. Because there's a lot of people who have suffered all kinds of torturing and so forth, and died, martyrs of various kinds, been eaten by the wild animals and so forth. That's Jesus, his main suffering. Ellen White makes this very clear. She says his main suffering was a sense of his loss of connection to his Father. Well, so serious that his physical pain was hardly felt. That's what we're talking about. We're talking about the second death. He was crushed by the fact that he was being separated from his Father. He was losing contact with his Father. We don't even begin to comprehend what that means. So you start talking about the crown of thorns and the beatings. And those are nothing. For Jesus' concern, that was basically nothing.
Someone said that the greater capacity you have to love, the greater capacity you have to hurt. So the one who loves the most is going to hurt the most when that separation occurs.
Well, we need to move on with our lesson. Jesus had taken his disciples on to Caesarea Philippi. You can visit Caesarea Philippi even today. And there are left there bits and pieces of a number of pagan temples to the goat gods and to the Pan, the all-powerful god, and da-da-da, all these other kinds of things. And it's possible that Jesus walked his disciples through that, and they looked and they saw those things, and this was strange for them, because there's nothing like that in the Jewish territory. And finally Jesus says, and you, who do you say? Well, first of all, let's read what it says. This is a familiar passage, but it's very significant. Jesus went to the territory near the town of Caesarea Philippi, where he asked his disciples. I'm reading from Matthew 16, starting with verse 13. Where he asked his disciples, who do people say the Son of Man is? Some say John the Baptist, they answered. Of course, remember, Herod had said, it's John the Baptist risen from the dead. That's why he has the power to do all these things. Others say Elijah, because Malachi 4 says Elijah's going to come back. While others say Jeremiah, and there's some hints that maybe Jeremiah is coming back. Some, that other prophet. Who's the other prophet? You know? In Deuteronomy 18:15, Moses says, God is going to send another prophet like me. So that's the other prophet. And of course, it's referring to Jesus. So Jesus goes on, what about you? He asked them, who do you say I am? Simon Peter answered, and here's impulsive Peter banging out his answer, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Jesus responds, good for you, Simon, son of John. Answered Jesus, for this truth did not come to you from any human being, but it was given to you directly by my Father in heaven. How did that happen?
It would be through the influence of the Holy Spirit.
Well, what would cause Peter to say that? He had seen miracles, he had seen feeding of thousands, he had seen devils driven out, he had seen walking on the water, even himself, he had been walking on the water temporarily. He'd seen dead people raised to life.
And there are biblical, Old Testament biblical passages that says those would be the signs of the Messiah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I think one thing that led him to say that was he wanted Jesus to be the Messiah.
Yeah. Well, and that's the problem. Because his idea of the Messiah was very, very different than Jesus' idea of what the Messiah
That's
was going to be.
They didn't understand when he went through all the explanation. They had their mindset it was going to be like this.
So they must have worried about the fact that John the Baptist had just been beheaded. So think about this just for a moment. How do you think you would have related to someone like Jesus? Here's a person, I mean, every day you get a surprise. Amazing things. He's sleeping in a boat that's about to sink in the waves in the Sea of Galilee. Finally, they wake him up. He stands up, peace be still, whoosh, and the water's flat, and you're going. I mean, think about how that would impact a fisherman who spent his life out on that lake. Well, there's a lot of verses, Galatians 4:4 and Hebrews 7:26, Isaiah 9:6, Luke 2:10 and 11, that suggest that, you know, this is the time, God has prepared the time, He sends His Son, this is God Almighty in human flesh. There's no question about the fact that the disciples witnessed things that no human being had ever seen before. So this was an incredible experience for them. I mean, every day, they must have gone home, I think, and just prayed, God, what are we going to see tomorrow? Well, how did Jesus respond when Peter said, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God? Did Jesus say, hallelujah, got it, go and tell everybody?
Keep it quiet.
Keep it quiet? Why would you keep something like that quiet?
Because they had the wrong message.
They had the totally wrong idea, and all the people they would have said that to had the totally wrong idea of what the Messiah was supposed to be.
And that would have interfaced with Rome.
So the idea that, I mean, their idea of the Messiah was he was going to help them get rid of the Romans. The thought, even the remotest thought that Jesus was going to end up going up to Jerusalem, being handed over to the Romans and be crucified by the Romans, was unthinkable to them.
We have the New Testament, which starts with the mm-hmm. four Gospels. They didn't have that then.
Yeah.
Where did it come to that idea that the Messiah was going to come and relieve them of all of their hardships, be their ruler?
Where did that idea come from?
Well, the Old Testament is filled with
things. So when you get to Christ's
not
time,
filled, but there
how
are some.
Change that? I mean, that's a totally different, what he's saying is totally different than what they expected.
Okay, let me very briefly try to answer that. There are passages in the Old Testament, especially like places like Daniel, and in Zechariah, and a few places like that, that we now believe that should be connected with either His second coming or possibly His third coming. But they had no idea about a second coming or third coming. They had lumped all those ideas together, and they believed that when the Messiah came the first time, He was going to conquer all the nations, He was going to set up His kingdom, He's going to rule the world. And they had come to that conclusion by lumping all those Old Testament passages together to apply to the first coming. That's what had happened.
But you can understand a little better why the disciples, mm-hmm. after 2.5 years, you would have thought they would have gotten it, but this was so ingrained for hundreds of years.
They were sure that this Messiah was going to come and free them from the Roman yoke. They could not imagine that Jesus would be handed over to the Romans to be crucified. Just unthinkable.
What exactly did he mean in verse 19? The keys of the kingdom of heaven, and that I can kind of figure, but what does he mean by what you bind and what you loose? I don't think I've ever heard a sermon on that anywhere.
Okay. Oh, you should have. If you haven't, I'm sorry.
Did I recall?
There's two things that you need to know about that passage. Roman Catholics will make a big deal about the fact that he hands the keys to Peter
right. In
this verse. Yeah. Okay, and in all of the symbols of the papacy, there are the keys.
Jeez.
This is the keys they're talking about. What they don't want you to do is move over to chapter 18. I've forgotten
verse
exactly.
18.
Huh?
Verse 18.
Also. Verse 18. Let's just do that really quick. Look at Matthew 18:18. And so I tell all of you, what you prohibit on earth will be prohibited in heaven, and what you permit on earth will be permitted in heaven. So Jesus has handed the keys to how many people? All of the disciples, including all of us, because the keys is the truth. The keys are the Bible. You don't have one key to hell and one key to heaven and say, I don't like the looks of you. I'm sending you to hell. I have another key to heaven. I like the looks of you. I'm going to send you to heaven. No, we don't. We have the scripture. We have the word of God. That's the keys. And we give it to people the best we can. And how they respond determines which way they will go. We have no control over that whatsoever.
And Peter used those keys at Pentecost, and he used them in Caesarea with the centurion, and all of the, you know, everything opened up.
Yeah.
From there.
Okay. Well, we need to remember that Caesarea Philippi was not Jewish territory, but rather Gentile territory. The disciples were beginning to see that Jesus was determined to minister to Gentiles as well as to Jews. What a repulsive thought, right? Thus, his ministry would extend far beyond the ministries of John the Baptist, Elijah, or Jeremiah, or for that matter, any of the other Old Testament prophets. Jesus' favorite title for himself was
Son of Man.
Son of Man. What is he implying when he says Son of Man? He's saying,
one of us.
Yeah, he's one of us. He's saying, I am completely and fully human. That's what he's saying. Well, can you mention some things that Jesus has done for you personally? I'm sure we all could if we had the time. People may, and one of the things about using your personal testimony, and Gordon, you mentioned earlier that, and we're going to come back to this, those two demon-possessed men, Jesus sent them back, and what do they know? All they knew was their personal experience, and their encounter with Jesus was very brief.
A few minutes.
And what happened when Jesus came back to that territory a little bit later?
Thousands
of people came out to see who was that had done this incredible thing. So people can argue with your interpretation of Scripture. They can argue with your interpretation of scientific facts. But it's pretty hard for them to argue with your personal experience. So Jesus demonstrated that to the two demoniacs. Well, moving on. So I tell you, Matthew 16:18-20. So I tell you, Peter, you are a rock, and on this rock foundation, my Good News Bible says, I will build my church, and not even death will ever be able to overcome it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, that's what we've just been talking about. What you prohibit on earth will be prohibited in heaven, what you permit on earth will be permitted in heaven. Then Jesus ordered his disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. But I thought the whole purpose of his coming to this earth was to tell people that he was the Messiah. So why is he telling them not to tell anybody? We just said it a little bit ago.
Time had not yet come, so he had to proceed with due caution.
And they had a completely wrong idea of who the Messiah was or what the Messiah was going to do. So if Jesus had said, go out and tell the world that I'm the Messiah, what would they have said? Come and gather around. We're going to take Jesus up to Jerusalem. We're going to make him king.
And they would have been heavily believed, because these are his most intimate friends.
Yeah, exactly.
These people spent time with him. They are his appointed messengers.
Now, who was this rock that Jesus is talking about? There's a pebble, a small rock, Petros, and there's this rock foundation, Petra in Greek. We can make a big deal out of that, but I think we can take another approach which is more convincing. What did Peter himself say about the rock? This is Acts 4 in Peter's sermon. Peter, full of the Holy Spirit, answered, leaders of the people and elders, and I'm going to, because of our shortness of time, I'm going to drop down to verse 11. Jesus is the one of whom the scripture says, the stone that you builders despised turned out to be the most important of all. Who does Peter say the stone is?
Christ.
Very clearly. Does he say anything like that anywhere else? Look at 1 Peter 2:4-8. Come to the Lord, the living stone, rejected by people as worthless, but chosen by God as valuable. Come as living stones, and let yourselves be used in building the spiritual temple, where you will serve as holy priests to offer spiritual and acceptable sacrifices to God through Jesus Christ. For the scripture says, I chose a valuable stone, and he's already told us who that stone is, right? Which I am placing as a cornerstone in Zion, and whoever believes in him will never be disappointed. This stone is of great value for you that believe, but for those who do not believe, the stone which the builders rejected as worthless turned out to be the most important of all. And another scripture says, this is the stone that will make people stumble, the rock that will make them fall. They stumbled because they did not believe in the word. Such was God's will for them. So, and all that refers to what does he say back here at the beginning? Come to the Lord, the what? The living stone, rejected by people. So, Peter made it very clear in his first gospel that the living stone refers to
Jesus.
And there's many places. I mean, we could take a long time and go all through the Old Testament and see many, many places where God is referred to as the rock of our salvation, the this, the stone, the rock, the whatever. So in light of all that, Peter and the rest of us humans, how do we come out? What do we look like? Ellen White put it in these words, how feeble the church appeared when Christ spoke these words. There was only a handful of believers against whom all the power of demons and evil men would be directed. Yet the followers of Christ were not to fear. Built upon the rock of their strength, they could not be overthrown. Desire of Ages, page 413, paragraph 3. Well, as you look back on your own personal experience and the experiences of those with whom you are familiar, do you see fallibility and weakness, or do you see permanence like a rock? Do I need to comment further?
Weakness.
Then we come to a perfect example of that in Matthew 16, starting with verse 21. From that time on, Jesus began to say plainly to his disciples, we've already talked about that part. So what was Peter's response when Jesus says he was going to go up and die? Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. God forbid it, Lord. He said, that must never happen to you. So at this point in time, it seems like Peter's starting to understand what Jesus is saying, right? Doesn't that sound like that? So how did Jesus respond to him? Jesus turned around and said to Peter, get away from me, Satan. You are an obstacle in my way because these thoughts of yours don't come from God, but from human nature. And right up there above, he said, who revealed this to you?
Holy Spirit.
My Father who is in heaven. Okay. So how do we get from being motivated by the Father in heaven to get thee behind me, Satan?
In a few minutes.
In a few minutes is right.
Pretty quick.
Very quickly. Well, look at Mark 8:33, just to make the point more clearly. Jesus turned around, looked at his disciples, and rebuked Peter. So Matthew seemed to say that he took Peter a little bit to the side. So when he's rebuking him, he's like almost in private. But what does Mark say? And who, by the way, who is Mark's gospel really come from?
Peter.
From Peter. So Peter says what? He looked at all the disciples, not just me. He looked at all the disciples. He said, get away from me, Satan. He said, your thoughts don't come from God, but from human nature. So all of the disciples had what? The same mistaken, erroneous idea about who the Messiah was going to be, right? Well, moving on, Matthew 16, 24 to 7, what happens next? Now imagine this. I try to close my eyes and think how I would have responded if I had been one of these disciples. Then Jesus said to his disciples, if anyone wants to come with me, he must forget self, carry his cross, and follow me. And they must have said, what? Carry a cross? How did that get in this story?
Looking back, you know, cross. You know,
yeah, we don't think too much of it looking back, but
looking forward,
to them,
quite shocking.
Where did the cross come from? For whoever wants to save his own life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. Will people gain anything if they win the whole world but lose their life? Of course not. There's nothing you can give to regain life, for the Son of Man is about to come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and then reward each one according to his deeds. So all of a sudden the disciples say, yeah, that's what we're waiting for, right? God is going to come. He's going to come to Jerusalem, and Jesus is going to be king, and he's going to reward all of us for what we have done. Don't you suppose that's how they responded? I assure you that there are some here who will not die until they have seen the Son of Man come as King. Amen. Right? I mean, think about it. How would you have responded? So, what are we going to do next? Well, think about the time when you were maybe 7th grade or 8th grade and people are starting to ask you, what do you want to do when you grow up? And what would your response be? What would have your response been back in those days?
I don't know. I remember that question.
Somewhat simplistic, I would think.
2 years earlier, fireman or garbage collector, garbage man.
Jesus called a small, we'll see this later, he called a small child of them and says, if you want to be great, be like a child. And they must have said, this guy is completely upside down and backwards, right?
And children were seen and not heard.
Mm-hmm. Well, what happened next in the story? Look at Matthew 17. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and the brothers James and John and led them up a high mountain where they were alone. Now, this is not an Everest kind of a mountain. Nothing like that along the side of the Sea of Galilee or the Jordan River. We don't know exactly which mountain this was, but something. As they looked on, a change came over Jesus. His face was shining like the sun, and his clothes were dazzling white. Then the three disciples saw Moses and Elijah talking with Jesus. By the way, how did they know it was Moses and Elijah?
Probably by
big
the things name, that they were told.
Nameplates?
Hmm? Probably by the things that Moses and Elijah said,
probably.
Or that Jesus said, or
maybe
the Holy Spirit gave that information to
them.
So
Peter spoke up and said to Jesus, Lord, how good it is that we are here. If you wish, I will make three tents here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. While he was talking, a shining cloud came over them, and a voice from the cloud said, this is my own dear son with whom I am pleased. Listen to him. When the disciples heard the voice, they were so terrified that they threw themselves face downwards on the ground. Jesus came to them and touched them. Get up, he said, don't be afraid. So they looked up and saw no one there but Jesus. What happened there?
They encountered divinity unveiled.
Mm-hmm.
But if you'd never seen anything like that, I mean, that would scare the living daylights out of me.
Yeah.
It would be, I mean, if they went back to their homes and tried to explain it, what would they say?
Jesus told them not to.
Yeah,
why wouldn't you feel comfortable in that? Situation.
Well, that's
Why
the question.
Would you be afraid?
Because you've never seen God in that way.
Maybe it was a booming voice.
If an angel appeared suddenly in this room, would you say, oh, hey? Or would you suddenly, I mean, it's not something that we're accustomed to. It's not natural for some shining being suddenly to appear.
We have several stories in the Bible where this did happen.
Mm-hmm. And they always fell with their noses
That's
in the
right.
dirt.
They were told, get up, wait, we need to talk to you here. I've got
fear not was always the first thing that they said.
Well, look at these comments from Ellen White. But before the crown must come the cross. Not the inauguration of Christ as king, but the decease to be accomplished at Jerusalem is the subject of their conference with Jesus. Bearing the weakness of humanity and burdened with its sorrow and sin, Jesus walked alone in the midst of men. As the darkness of the coming trial pressed upon him, he was in loneliness of spirit in a world that knew him not. Even his loved disciples, absorbed in their own doubt and sorrow and ambitious hopes, had not comprehended the mystery of his mission. He had dwelt amid the love and fellowship of heaven, but in the world that he had created, he was in solitude. Now heaven had sent its messengers to Jesus, not angels, but men who had endured suffering and sorrow and who could sympathize with the Savior in the trial of his earthly life. Moses and Elijah had been co-laborers with Christ. They had shared his longing for the salvation of men. Moses had pleaded for Israel, yet now, if thou wilt forgive them their sin, and if not, blot me, I pray thee, out of thy book which thou hast written. think about that. Elijah had known loneliness of spirit as for 3 years and a half of famine he had borne the burden of the nation's hatred and its woe. Alone he had stood for God upon Mount Carmel. Alone he had fled to the desert in anguish and despair. These men, chosen above every angel around the throne, had come to commune with Jesus concerning the scenes of his suffering and to comfort him with the assurance of the sympathy of heaven. The hope of the world, the salvation of every human being, was the burden of that interview. Desire of Ages 422 to 425.
Similar things are supposed to happen to the remnant toward the end of time. Mm-hmm. Is there any information to indicate that they will have a similar experience?
Yes.
Time when God will come near and encourage them and...
There's some hints like that. Well, why do you think God chose Moses and Elijah? Yes, Gordon.
The end of chapter 16 says, some of you won't die until you've seen the Son of Man come as king. Yeah. Was this event 6 days later, the transfiguration, was that what he was referring to?
Yes. Yeah. Some of them did not die, and they saw Jesus come effective. By the way, one of the very interesting things about this is that Jesus' body was infused with divinity at that point. He shone with the glory of God. Okay? If he had had any sin in him, he would have been consumed. Think about that for a moment. If he had had any sin in him, he would have been consumed. Well, look at Luke 9:31. And actually, it would be best to start early. Suddenly two men were there talking with him. This is still talking about the transfiguration. They were Moses and Elijah, who appeared in heavenly glory and talked with Jesus about the way in which he would soon fulfill God's purpose by dying in Jerusalem. So what was the topic of conversation?
The approaching suffering and trials.
Yes. Absolutely. And then suddenly that voice from heaven. Were they scared to death, or are they just overwhelmed? What's happening? The transfiguration narrative, this is something from our Bible, our teacher's guide, Bible study guide. The transfiguration narrative contains several allusions, possibly missed by modern readers, but nevertheless recognizable to Jewish readers, to God's glorious self-revelation for Moses at Sinai. In other words, we're going to compare now God's coming down on the top of Mount Sinai before the Jews in early Old Testament times with this transfiguration. So what are the comparisons? One, the 6 days recorded in Matthew 17:1 alluded to Exodus 24:16, when Moses had to wait for 6 days for God to welcome him up into the Mount Sinai. Clouds enshrouded God before his glorious revelation. Two, Jesus' facial transformation, that shining and beaming, reflected Moses' facial transformation caused by exposure to God's divine glory, Exodus 34:29, when he came down the second time after being with God for 40 days. So another parallel. Both Elijah and Moses experienced Jehovah firsthand at the mountain, that is at Sinai. When did Elijah go to Mount Sinai?
Heard the still small voice.
Where he heard the still small voice after the Mount Carmel situation, right? Four, the Israelites had lived in tabernacles, that would be tents, during their wilderness travel, surrounded by God's presence. So Peter says, let me build three what?
Tents.
Okay. Five, God's voice called Moses from the cloud, while God's voice affirmed Jesus from the cloud. So here's God's voice. When it comes time for the actual action, God's voice comes right out of heaven. Both cases. And six, the disciples' fearful reaction reflected the wonderment experienced by ancient Israel whenever encountering God. So just as the disciples went down flat and with their faces in the dirt, all of ancient Israel did back at the foot of Mount Sinai. Very parallel situation. Well, shortly thereafter, this experience, Jesus returned briefly to Capernaum. We read about it in Matthew 17:24 to 27. When Jesus and his disciples came to Capernaum, the disciples of the collectors of the temple tax came to Peter and asked, does your teacher pay the temple tax? Of course, Peter answered. When Peter went into the house, Jesus spoke up first. Simon, what is your opinion? Who pays duties are taxes to the kings of this world, the citizens of the country or the foreigners? The foreigners, answered Peter. Well then, replied Jesus, that means that the citizens don't have to pay. We don't want to offend these people, so go to the lake, drop in a line. Now, what was Peter's usual way of fishing?
Nets.
With nets. He says, go to the lake, drop in a line, pull up the first fish you hook, and in his mouth you'll find a coin worth enough for my temple tax and yours. Take it and pay them our taxes. Now, I wish we had time to read the whole story. This is an absolutely incredible story, but what's happened? So they thought they had Jesus coming or going. If he says yes, pay the tax, they say, well, he recognized that he's not any ordinary person, because Levites and priests and rabbis did not have to pay the tax. So they thought if he says yes, they'll just claim, you see, he knows that he's not a rabbi. If he says no, what were they going to say? He's not loyal to the temple. So they thought they had him going either way, and of course Jesus did his usual thing, and he escaped out to the side. So they said, well, now how did he pay the tax? Well, let me tell you about that. Peter threw a line into the lake, pulled out one fish, and there's the tax, and wow, okay. Well, and we know the rest of that story. I don't have time to go through it. Why don't you think Jesus made a big deal out of that? He could have embarrassed these people. He just said, there's no reason to make a big deal out of this. Just quietly pay the tax. So we're coming to the end of our time. If you would be interested in some of these materials that we use in our handout and our discussion here, they're available on our website at theox, that's theox.org. So in conclusion, some biblical scholars try to suggest this story is just a bit of a folktale. But we know for sure that this was a real story. There are other stories like the floating axe head in 2 Kings 6 and the dry feast and the wet fleece for Gideon in Judges 6. There have been other times like this, but this is the only time in the story of Jesus where he apparently did something that in a sense was for his own benefit. But it wasn't really for his own benefit. What was it really for? It was to prove that he wasn't just an ordinary citizen. He was, in fact, the true Messiah, the Son of the living God. And it should be very clear that disciples needed to have a very clear understanding of the identity of Jesus, and they didn't get it until later. So what's your idea of who the Messiah is? What did he accomplish through all of that? Our wonderful Father, we thank you for these stories from Scripture that are set out so clearly and wonderfully so that we can see the truth about your character, about your coming, about what Jesus came to accomplish. We want to thank you once again for what you did. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.